Thank you, Ambassador Gupta. I must sort of preface this, obviously, by thanking the organizers, especially my dear friends, actually, Smriti and Ashok. And of course, it was lovely to see Ambassador Jain there. As I was saying to him that probably his good words about me are going to end today because I'm going to disappoint a lot of you by not being too scholarly. But I think maybe that's the, in some ways, that is the topic that I'm going to talk about. Well, first thing, I find it quite interesting because I think our culture and that a particular culture has led to a number of issues that Pakistan is still reeling with. So what I will talk to you about is we do generally know what is happening in Pakistan and what kinds of things have happened. It's a very much a learned audience, so I should actually be on the other side. But what I will talk about mainly is how this idea of a culture was understood in Pakistan's formative phase. That's something which I'm currently working on. I'm working on a book about how Pakistan was actually imagined after the country was created. You will find a lot of books on the imagination of Pakistan before that. There's a very interesting book that just came out by Dr. Venkat Dulipala on how Pakistan was very well imagined. You know, it's quite a thick book, about 800 pages. The only problem is Pakistan was very well imagined in Uttar Pradesh. Just not where it actually, you know, was. So there was a lot of imagination, but what did that really mean? You know, once you actually have the country, I found it quite bizarre that no one was discussing the fact, no scholar was discussing the fact that, you know, well, now you have it, what is going to happen now? And I am looking mainly at the debates of the Constituent Assembly in trying to see what kind of country these people wanted to create. And the question of culture and identity, and of course, both these things are directly related to politics, became very central right at the outset of it. So I'll speak about just a couple of themes that came up. First, and I find it really fascinating, is that the founder, even the founder of Pakistan, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, and the first Prime Minister, Liaquat Ali Khan, they weren't quite sure what Islam was, actually. When they used the word Islam, they used it in such broad strokes that no one really knew what it meant. And it could be personal interpretation, it could be clerical interpretation, it could be communal interpretation, it could be anything. But that, I argue, was one of the central themes why Pakistan ended up in this very bizarre quandary that it's still in. That Pakistan was demanded, yes, in the name of Islam. I think that's very clear. The 1946 election that the Muslim League won in most of the Muslim majority provinces was on the basis of Pakistan. They used very interesting tactics for that. That's another matter, of course. But once you have a country that's in the name of Islam, well, you need to really say, well, what kind of Islam? What does it actually mean? And for a long time, I really believed that these members of the Constituent Assembly, you know, that lawmaking body, really knew what it meant. So I, you know, went through the through the debates and realized that they were using Islam as, you know, in a scholarly way, you would use the word liberalism. So 19th century liberalism is what they, in fact, thought Islam was. And they very much believed in a personal interpretation of Islam. And, you know, they had, I would really say, a very strange notion of what it was. And I'll give you very interesting examples. These are all examples after Pakistan was actually created. So this is one very interesting thing. So Jinnah spoke to the Karachi Bar Association in January 1948. So just a few months after Pakistan was created, he is speaking to an audience of distinguished lawyers. And they were discussing what kind of constitution Pakistan should have. And this is what Jinnah said, that he could not understand that a section of the people who deliberately wanted to create mischief had made propaganda that the constitution of Pakistan would not be made on the basis of the Shariat. So he's basically saying, yes, of course, it will be made on the basis of the Shariat. This is after, again, I emphasize the creation of Pakistan. But in the same speech, he also said this: Islam and its idealism have taught democracy. Islam has taught equality, justice, and fair play to everybody. What reason is there to fear democracy, equality, freedom on the highest standard of integrity and on the basis of fair play and justice for everybody? Let us make it the future constitution of Pakistan. We shall make it and we will show it to the world.
So on the one hand, he is very clear that yes, Sharia should be the basis of the constitution. And then he talks about, you know, democracy, equality and freedom, which, you know, of course, are things that no one will disagree with. So there is this great sense of confusion over what these actual tenets are. And there's this other very interesting incident where someone actually asks Jinnah in an interview, saying, well, what do you actually mean when you use Islamic principles? You know, what kind of Islamic principles are you really, really talking about? So Jinnah uses the example of women, and this is what he says. The position of women is already equal in law to that of men. It may be expected that their participation in civic affairs and in the professions will increase, and that the institution of parda, which is the result of tradition and not the teachings of the Quran, will gradually disappear. In the old, old days, it was a good idea, since in the autocratic past, a king or a chieftain might take to himself any beautiful woman he saw. And the man was wise indeed to keep his women under cover. Custom throughout the world tends to outlive the reason for its origin. And this is no exception. In the modern state, such a precaution is not necessary, and it is already on the way out. So here you have, you know, something that a lot of normally people would consider a very Islamic thing, you know, parda, or in the modern interpretation, hijab, and all of that. And here's Jinnah saying, well, that's just a social custom that has crept in, and it's not according to the Quran, and therefore, you know, this will be thrown out, and it's already on its way out. So that's a very modernist streak in which he's interpreting, a bit like, and I hope when Dr. Rubina Sehgal talks about it, a bit about like Sir Syed Ahmed Khan, who had this very modern interpretation of Islam. And here's what Jinnah is also making here. So there was this very strange kind of a view of what actually Islam might actually mean for the place. And there are these a number of contradictions that actually go on from there. Then I can even give you another couple of examples, which I think, again, say which kind of a polity did Jinnah wanted to create. So when he talks about democracy, he says, and this is in February 1948, and I quote, "I have one underlying principle in mind, the principle of Muslim democracy. It is my belief that our salvation lies in following the golden rules of conduct set for us by our great lawgiver, the Prophet of Islam. Let us lay the foundation of our democracy on the basis of truly Islamic ideals and principles." And I could go on and on and on. And it's really fascinating that he always says, well, Islamic ideals and principles, but what are those principles and who is actually going to define them remains an issue. At that time, of course, it was an issue, but I think even now it remains an issue. Now, the next thing that I want to talk about is, so here's, I think we have premised this by saying, well, yes, it was Islamic culture and Islamic tradition, but what does this really mean? It was never really defined. And this confusion in the next point goes on to this most important document called the Objectives Resolution that the Constituent Assembly of Pakistan passed in March 1949. And there also, it's very interesting how they interpret the modern state. So the first clause of the of the Objectives Resolution, the first article says, "Whereas sovereignty over the entire universe belongs to God Almighty alone, and the authority which is delegated to the state of Pakistan through its people for being exercised within the limit prescribed by him is a sacred trust." Now, for all the people who are here, at least lawyers, I'm sure you all realize this doesn't mean anything. What does this actually mean? Where does sovereignty lie? In about three lines, it's so confused and muddled, you have no clue where it lies. Because, so sovereignty belongs to you know, I'm just giving you a very short précis of the interpretation of this. So sovereignty belongs to God. God has delegated it to the state of Pakistan. So the state comes next. Through its people. So the people have a role through the state to be exercised within the limits prescribed by God. Now, the question is, who's going to tell you what the limits are? And if you look through the debates of the Constituent Assembly, the non-Muslim members keep asking, well, what are those limits? And there's this very fascinating discussion where the Prime Minister Yaqoob Khan says, well, everyone knows those limits. And a Hindu member of parliament says, well, I don't, can you tell me? And he's like, well, you must know them. And so, well, I don't know them, can you tell me? And it never gets defined. And that really becomes a very interesting debate. Then it goes on and says, wherein the principles of democracy, freedom, equality, tolerance, and social justice as enunciated by Islam shall be fully observed. So you not only have the culture, you know, that's one entity, you have the whole polity being defined as enunciated by Islam. And again, there was a discussion on this point and saying, well, how does Islam enunciate these principles? And again, the very interesting answer from the treasury benches was, well, you all know that. I was like, well, we don't really know that. Can you tell us? And they kept saying, well, it's obvious to everyone. I was like, well, it's not obvious to everyone. Can you like spell it out? What does it mean? And it even goes this far as the treasury bench is saying, well, you guys know us, so we are all friends, and you know, we won't treat you badly. And say, well, what if you die? Even that kind of a discussion happened. Well, what if you die and someone else interprets it in a very different way? What is going to happen then? So there's this very unclear thing that you have based a country on a notion of a culture and of an identity, but there is this great distrust of actually describing what that culture and identity actually means. And I think that in its core has created huge problems for Pakistan. And I would argue that has actually created this very antagonistic feeling in Pakistan towards assimilation of any other identity or culture, because what it defines itself officially, it is not clear what that actually means. So if it doesn't know what that actually means, how can it allow for multiculturalism, and how can it allow the state to be comfortable with expressions of multiple identities when the identity it defines for itself, it hasn't really defined? Now, before I actually go on towards the sort of the last bit, I'm looking at the time and it's ticking very fast, actually. It's a fast clock for me. But what I will say is actually here, one of the things in the Constituent Assembly, I've just finished the chapter on the Constituent Assembly, on the objectives resolution, and hence I'm slightly too excited about it. But what's very interesting is that in the Constituent Assembly, one member of parliament, who is a cleric, Maulana Shabir Ahmed Usmani, actually says very interestingly, he actually defines what is going to happen in Pakistan. And it's quite bizarre that very few people actually picked up on this. He actually says, and this is, I think, very, very interesting, an Islamic state is not a state in its own right, with authority inherent in it. So it's not a state that has its own authority from the people or anywhere. It is a state to which authority has been delegated. The real sovereignty belongs to God. Man is his vice regent on earth and discharges his obligations in this respect alone with other religious duties on the principle of, and a special quote that he uses and says, a state within a state and within the limits prescribed by God. So again, he's actually talking about, you know, what, you know, there are limits to the state, and the government again doesn't describe who these people are. But most significantly, he actually goes on to explain, well, what kind of people will actually be involved in this state? And he says, it is evident that such a state, which is founded on some principles, be it theocratic or secular, like the USSR, can be run only by those who believe in those principles. People who do not subscribe to those ideas may have a place in the administrative machinery, but they cannot be entrusted with the responsibility of framing the general polity of the state or dealing with matters vital to its safety and integrity. So, you know, this whole debate of, you know, the Muslim versus the non-Muslim, he has very clearly said, well, because the state is actually based on the idea of a Muslim polity, non-Muslims automatically do not believe in that Muslim polity, because if they did, they'd be Muslim. Would not be a part of it. They might have some role in it, but they won't have an equal part of it. So he was a bit clear of which direction it was going, but generally the government wasn't quite sure. So what's the result of all of this? The result of all of this is that the lack of clarity of what the culture and the identity of Pakistan constituted right at the beginning. You know, we always talk about, oh, Zia came and this happened, Zia came and that happened. Every single thing that Zia-ul-Haq did, you can find within the first 3 years of Pakistan. You know, Zia-ul-Haq instituted zakat and ushr. That was discussed in 1949-50. Zia wrote the textbooks. The first time the government of Pakistan said, which I actually said in my last talk here a couple of years ago, that was said by the government in December 1947, that the government should write the textbooks.
history is too important to be left to the scholars. That is what the Minister of Education said right in December 1947. So everything what Ziadeh did, in fact, was discussed in the first couple of years, so much so that there was a discussion in the parliament about using the word God or Allah. And the law minister, Mr. A.K. Broi, who was a distinguished lawyer even in pre-partition times, actually gave like a two-page speech explaining the difference between God and Allah, and saying that God is a limited concept, where Allah is a much greater concept, and you know that Muslims should use the word Allah. So when that happened practically during Zia's time, it was very late in the day actually that that was happening. You know, perhaps at some level that should have happened earlier. So therefore, I argue that this unclarity over what its culture really means and what does it constitute leads to very bizarre and strange reactions in Pakistan. And I know all of you know, so I'll just quickly go through that. You know, the imposition of one language in Pakistan, that is, you know, that was the root cause for the separation of Bangladesh, you know, not accepting Bengali as co-equal to Urdu. And even actually, it's very fascinating, even accepting Urdu when the majority of the country didn't even speak it as a first language was in fact a very big issue there. And there is a very interesting anecdote that once a couple of government ministers, who were actually all of them were from the UP, went to Peshawar. And they all thought, oh, of course, everyone spoke Urdu. And they were very shocked to find that people didn't speak Urdu there. People spoke Pashto. And one of them, and I know this anecdote because my father was actually there. So one of the ministers turned to my father and said, I just thought all Muslims in India spoke Urdu. You know, so at some level, perhaps there wasn't that much awareness even that there was this cultural diversity amongst the Muslims of India. And it just wasn't the UP Ashraf that constituted the Muslim polity. But because of this unclear comprehension of the idea, they even practically banned the usage of Punjabi in the Punjab Assembly. Very recently, actually in the last 10, 15 years, you have been allowed to speak in Punjabi. And even when Sindh made Sindhi the official language with Urdu and English, there were newspaper reports that just because of the fact that Sindh has made Sindhi co-equal to Urdu and English in the province, it wants to leave Pakistan. And therefore, no other province has tried to even make its local language as the official language. And there have been continuous attempts, even now, the most recent one, you know, and I find it really fascinating, and perhaps I'll end at that. You know, after 40 years, the Supreme Court picked up on that injunction that said that eventually Urdu should replace English as the official language of Pakistan. And our former Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, Justice Jawades Khwaja, actually penned this long opinion on that and said that the time has come for Urdu to be enforced. And what's really, really fascinating is that even in that opinion, he's used a lot of English words. So I wrote to him saying that, you know, even when trying to use, you know, what we call Salis Urdu, you end up using a lot of English, which actually shows how much English has actually become a part of the local milieu, you know. And I actually mentioned this in an article too, that, you know, in an area, again, in South Asia, when the first English book was even published about 300 years ago, treating English as something outside the culture is completely bizarre, because that, in fact, has actually become very much meshed with the culture here. And, you know, you mentioned earlier, is the chicken tikka Indian or Pakistani? And I was wondering, dare say that in Manchester or Birmingham, because they'll get really, really annoyed because they actually think that they made it up. So, you know, it's not just a South Asian way of thinking. It is much, much broader. So what's the way forward? Well, you know, in Pakistan, one can write perhaps 20 books on this and still be unsure. But the obvious way forward, of course, for Pakistan is to develop something of, you know, I would say, learning from either India or, in fact, from Bangladesh, which was once a part of Pakistan, and how different identities need not one to be clearly defined. You know, one of the real fascinating things that I find in the Constituent Assembly is that they want to define everything till the last dot. Well, maybe culture is a very fluid thing, which it is, and it keeps flowing in very different ways. So allow for that and not worry that in case something isn't according to your culture, that the whole country is going to fall apart. You know, whenever I actually teach in Pakistan and say all these kinds of things, all my students get really shocked. So I have to go and ask them and say, can you go out and see something? And they go out and say, what? And I say, Pakistan hasn't fallen apart. You know, it will still exist if tomorrow morning there is no two-nation theory. It will still exist if tomorrow morning Islam is no longer the central reason for its existence. It does exist, and it will exist, and it doesn't really matter if we reformulate it, if we rethink of it under different terms. And I'll just end with another very interesting thing, or how culture actually cannot even be controlled. So every year, about twice a year, I bring my students to Punjabi University in Patiala. And when I began doing it in 2013, a lot of the students were really excited. Oh, gee, hum India ja rahe hai, hum India ja rahe hai. So the first time I just brought them to Patiala and took them back, and every one of them badmouthed me and said, gee, kahan hume le gaye the? Matlab, they are just Punjabis with a turban. You know, that's about it. And they were really annoyed. So the next time I had to take them to Delhi and to Agra, you know, just to say that we are going to a new country. Because as long as you are in the Punjab, there isn't much of a difference, which in itself is very interesting, because nearly 70 years of forced separation between Eastern and West Punjab, you know, nearly three generations have passed. And if you look at the culture, of course, there has been change, but there hasn't been dramatic change. And that, I think, in itself speaks volumes about the force and the power of culture, and how it can, you know, transcend a separation of three generations and still be there. You know, everywhere we actually went in Patiala, people asked, oh yes, I had a cousin who lived in Lahore. Oh, and my aunt came from Gujranwala, this, that, and the rest. So there are all these kinds of things which even after nearly 70 years of separation still can still bind people together. So having a more broad view of what culture is, And not only as a factor in regional cooperation, but as perhaps the factor in regional cooperation, will, I think, lead to a more prosperous and cooperative and a more fun South Asia. Thank you.